Today we're going to be talking about the UK Vz.59, which is a Czechoslovakian design of the 1950s. Today's video is brought to you by Mark Colomar Firearms, which allowed us the generous use of their facilities, and we've been talking about them for the previous two episodes and of their machine guns and replications of machine guns. We also like to thank Ventura Munitions for the ammunition they provide us in various video reviews on the FPDB. Please give them a shout out. In addition to my friend Bresh, who helped with this video and helped with the production of making it. Thank you very much, Bresh. I appreciate it. So down to business here. The UK Vz.59 stands for Universal Version of 1959, which was the year the machine gun was adopted. The belt-fed machine gun was actually based on the Vz.52 light machine gun chambered in 7.62 by 4.5mm. This is not the Vz.52 rifle, for those of you who might be getting confused at this point. The Czechs had a large insistence in the 1950s to stick to their own designs and to stick to what they wanted to make to begin with. The Soviets tried pushing AKMs, Kalashnikovs, PKMs on the Czech Republic that was underneath Soviet influence, but the Czechs refused and they wanted to do their own thing. Eventually, they later on repented and they later adopted the 7.62 by 5.4mm cartridge. However, everything they had before that was chambered in 7.62 by 4.5, the Vz.52, the 58 rifle, and then later on it was switched over to the 7.62 by 3.9. So the UK 5.9 was chambered in 7.62 by 5.4 rimmed. There were two models. There was a light and a heavy barreled version. The heavy barrel version was a little bit longer than the light one. There were around 24,000 made in the period of the 1950s to the 1960s. There was also a 7.62 NATO version that was later on made to try to attract more customers outside of the Czech Republic. And an interesting note about the UK Vz.59 is that it is still used unto this day within the Czech military, although the Czech military is currently trying to replace it with the Mark 48 from FN Herstal. It is a open bolt design that is based on the Vz.37's gas system. It was also used by Slovak troops after Slovakia and Czechoslovakia split in the 1990s and is still used by Slovak troops today. Now that we've looked at some of the history of the UK Vz.59, let's look at some of the operating components. First and foremost, we need to look at the pistol grip that is also the charging handle for the system. The original machine gun version of the UK 5.9, you have to press the trigger in order to release the catch forward. It's a little precarious, but it seems to work out in the machine gun version. However, with the semi-automatic version, there is no trigger press in here, and Mark Holmar had to redesign the bolt to accommodate a semi-automatic only version that would be allowed to be approved by ATF. You have to press a lever on the left side of the firearm. Notice during the course of fire that the trigger actually also actuates a dust cover for the machine gun underneath as well. As you press the trigger with each round, the dust cover flips on and then flips off the machine gun. Right. So this is how the UKM and the UK 59 work. You've got your receiver, you've got, this is milled by the way, you've got your carrier, and then you've got your bolt head. So this fits in here. This is the forward position. This is the rear position, coming back into the bolt, and this is when it's locked. So to fit it in, first you have your receiver here, that fits in just like so. And now this has to be in the forward position for it to go forward, or else it's stuck. Boom, forward, that's in there. So now that's inside the receiver, you have your, it's in the lock, and you can see it, it's cammed. In those two little spots. There we go. Here it's locked. There it's not. Alright, so first things first, you've got this hammer or striker. The striker part, this goes in the upper portion, and you can fit it in right back there. And so, as you can tell, the striker goes forward and fires the firing pin. Boom, when it's released. Now let's fire some closed bolt position. So that means the striker is back here. Let's go, the spring goes forward. It hits it, fits the firing pin, ignites the cartridge. The gas pushes back on the piston. Bam, that unlocks it, and goes to the rear. At the same time, it goes back, drops the shell out,
through the bottom and then loads a new round in from the top, from the feed call.
So unlike other machine gun designs, the feed tray system is very different. Now, the Czechs had to use the Soviet ammunition, but they didn't have to use a Soviet belt. The belt is a non-disintegrating push-through tab, which means you can push the belt in after closing the feed tray and then pull it from the other end, and then the rounds will place themselves correctly. The feed tray cover actually doesn't have any moving components within it. All it is a simple cover. The actual moving components are the actual belt and the actual underlying components of the machine gun itself. The belt is configured in such a way that it actually helps to push the rounds out of their individual placements into the chamber. So although the machine gun could be fired from a bipod mount, the machine gun could also be mounted on a tripod. The original tripods had a lot of intuitiveness built into them. They could double function as an anti-aircraft mount, a prone mount, or a sitting mount. The anti-aircraft mount, we unfortunately weren't able to take the tripod out and show you, but you can see other videos on the internet showing how the tripod works. And essentially, you have to take the various legs apart and you put them in this weird contraption, and what you get is a standing mount that you can actually shoot from. In here, we're showing you how to take the tripod apart and facilitate it for movement use. This would allow a soldier to take the tripod down and then move it from position to position. Also note that the connection point for the tripod is actually on the top of the machine gun instead of on the bottom, like many other machine guns are. What this does is it puts the machine gun at a lower vantage point, and so you can get lower to the ground and have more cover with it. Of course, the Czechs had to compensate for this by making a taller rear sight to compensate for the tripod being in their way. And you could traverse and elevate the machine gun either finely or crudely on a wide range of areas. All this adjustment was done with your left hand without ever having to move your head from the machine gun or your other hand. The rear sight ladder for the UK-59 had to be elevated because it had to clear the tripod mount that would be attached to it. It had elevation tick marks that went up to 2,000 meters. In addition, it had an elevation point on the left and it had a windage adjustment on the right. Bear in mind, their front sight could be adjusted as well. When not in use, it flipped down against the top of the machine gun cover out of use while doing transportation. The butt pad of the UK-59 featured a shoulder latch that could be pushed up and down and could allow a gunner to have better stability when firing the machine gun from the prone. Bipods are of an extremely simple design, and they had two positions, either employed or racked up against the barrel. However, the bipod could also be completely removed in case one needed to take them off and maybe switch barrels that you would have to change in case of an emergency. They also had very loose tolerances, so the bipods didn't collapse and bend over when putting a lot of pressure on them. The handle was very unique on the machine gun because it had essentially three positions. It had just sort of an assault phase, an upper phase, a barrel changing phase, and then you could swivel it between all these. This further allowed you to take the barrel off of the machine gun when you needed to, and you could put it in a different position, whatever position was best for you, just by simply rotating it and pressing the latch. Depressing the feed tray cover and pushing it to the right allowed the entire barrel fixture to come off entirely. This is one of the faster methods of changing a barrel among a number of machine guns in the world. The bolt could still be pressed forward. Putting it back on, you just switch the latch to the left and then in the open position and press it down to continue. The UK-59 was fitted with an assault can that could fit a 50-round belt of 7.62x54 rimmed ammunition. Putting the assault can on the machine gun, it fixed on the right side, and it was latched to two little points next to the feed tray cover. This allowed the machine gun to be mobile and allowed gunners to run around with the machine gun if they needed to. For extended periods of time, such as in a vehicle mount, you could have an actual dedicated can that could have extended amounts of belts linked inside of it and that you could fire from for an extended amount of time. And so you wouldn't have to be confined to a 50-round assault can. I hope you enjoyed the video, guys. We really enjoyed making it, and we look forward to seeing you next time on the channel. Next time, we're going to be talking about the Soviet PKM general purpose machine gun. However, unlike the UK-59 we have here, the PKM that we're going to have in the video is actually going to be fully automatic. Thank you very much, and we hope to see you next time.